It's a golden year once again, and joining us today is Derren Brown, illusionist extraordinaire. Good
hello.
Day to you.
Hi, hello. This has been really fun. Thank you for having me on.
Great to have you here. Am I right? Is illusionist doesn't seem to cover it enough. Is that a good description?
I've never really known what to call it, so I'll take anything if it's said in a friendly manner. Yeah. Illusionist is fine.
Because there seems to be a huge appetite in the public at large to be fooled in some way, to have the wool pulled over their eyes. Presumably, you see that all the time.
We don't know what to do with mystery much in our world, and you know, a lot of life is mysterious to us, and how we integrate that into life is actually important. The sides of ourselves and the people we're close to, and parts of culture that are different. You know, this just important to integrate. And I think magic slightly tickles at that fascination we have with everything that's separate and different from us and mysterious in some way. So yeah, I think there's always been some appeal for it, isn't there? Particularly in the West, that kind of secular theatrical magic. Yeah, I've got a real fondness for it.
Yeah, and we're kind of looking for something else, perhaps, in our lives, and some things that we don't understand. We're quite intrigued by.
Yes, yeah, exactly. And the sort of magic that I've always done, I suppose, has been not so much about suspending disbelief, but kind of engaging belief. It's sort of been on the cusp of, is this real, is it not? And the show that I'm doing now, which is a proper magic show, like a family magic show, is really fun for me because we're just going back to that world of just all the rest of magic that I don't really normally touch. And it's been really, it's been a very exciting thing. I should say I've got a show on at the moment called Unbelievable, just in case that makes no sense to people. But it's a wonderful, fun, wondrous thing when it's done right. I think it often isn't, but when it is done right, it can be lovely.
We'll hear more about that in a little while, but we must think about your golden year, which was 1986.
Yes.
So you were just a boy.
15, right. I think. It was hard doing this. I didn't really have much of a musical landscape around me when I was growing up. I fell in with this sort of classical music-loving kids at school in my first year, which is not a good thing to do. I would not recommend that. We all hated each other. I didn't really know anything about classical music. But it just meant I bypassed the world of pop music and just didn't really have any sense of where my heart was musically at all until really I left school. But when I was thinking about what to choose, what was the first record I bought? And it's terrible and embarrassing. I'm sure we'll come to it in a moment. But then when I thought about that year, And I had a look on Google to see what other things were out that year. And one of my favourite songs, actually, which still is, also came out that year. So it definitely seemed the right year to do. But it was a weird... There's nothing that stitches these together other than the plight of a 15-year-old kid that doesn't know anything about music his heart lies.
That is all we need. You're a particular story for the age of 15. So Sweet Love by Anita Baker is the first one I'm going to play.
This is the one I love. I woke up, it was on Capital Radio one morning, and I woke up to it, and I was bowled over by it. And strangely, they played, and I've never heard it since, a song from the 30s. I think it's from the 30s. A very kind of what was that band called? The Ink Spots. It was very much. I don't think it was there, but it very much that sound.
It's never a heard close it. Close harmony sort of thing.
Exactly, yeah, and I think that was. Voice, I think there was an original song from that era that this was based on. But I love this, and I really got really into Anita Baker for years. So this is the. It's a glorious song, and it's really stayed with me ever since that morning.
So, 1986 is the year when Derren Brown was 15, and we're thinking about that year for you. Were you involved in magic or illusions at all?
No. I was shoplifting a bit.
Ooh.
I'd put a Luther Vandross cassette tape into my pocket. I set off the alarms. Ooh. I thought, I can't. I'm going to stop now. So, terrible. I don't say it with any pride. It's a bad thing. But yeah, I did have this. And I think, but a lot of magicians have had that, have had a bit of a phase of pilfering.
Interesting.
That's really what I think back to when I think of that age more than anything else. And I wasn't into magic, and I fear it may have started with that.
What saved you from that life of crime, if you like?
The alarms going off in Harrods. That was just the thought, Luther Vandross. There's not a way to go down.
You go for something other than Luther Vandross.
Mm.
So your next choice is Spitting Image.
Oh, God. So this is the first song I bought. I apologise to all the listeners. I mean, it is no disrespect to Spitting Image, but I mean, it's a pretty poor choice of song. But it is the first record I bought. And I said I had no musical taste. Spitting Image, Chicken Song on one side, and I think it was the Phil Collins sort of parody on the other side, and a South African song on the... Anyway, so I loved it, played it a lot, and then I think the second one I bought was Randy Crawford singing Almaz. I think that was that era as well.
Oh, that's quite a stretch there, yeah, from Chicken Song to Almaz.
Well, yeah, exactly. Soon after, I worked in a suit shop in Croydon with very cool guys, and they played a lot of soul music.
Yeah.
So it went Chicken Song, Randy Crawford, then sort of into Alexander O'Neill, Luther Vandross, Cameo, and that kind of weird world. So I found my way very strangely through music. But I really love that I'm making you play this song, and I just apologise to everybody. Please keep listening and keep going till the end, and then come back to us.
Thank you, Derren, for
thank
sharing.
Thank you, and apologies again.
Quite all right. So who were your first influences in the world of magic or illusions?
Well, I grew up with Paul Daniels, but I, rather than him, though, I think some of the guests he had on, some of them really stuck in my mind. There was a mentalist, which I suppose technically is what I am, called Max Maven, who's recently passed away, very sadly, who was sort of amazing, and he had this big sort of exaggerated widow's peak and sort of panda eye makeup and dressed in this sort of black tunic, extraordinary coiffured goatee and this deep voice. Anyway, he was a guest a lot, and I just remember thinking, why is he not on the news? It was extraordinary. It was a mind reader figure. Anyway, so there are a couple of people like that I remember. But then years later at university, I saw a hypnotist, a very good hypnotist called Martin S. Taylor, and he was performing at Bristol University where I was. And that was it for me. It just clicked. It was the first week of uni. I had this whole law degree ahead of me, which I didn't really have much interest in. So I spent all my time hypnotizing other students. And then because I remember he did a few magic tricks informally afterwards, he had questions and answers and so on. So because he was my only role model, I then ended up picking up a book on magic tricks somewhere. And then gradually I did less hypnosis and more magic. But it was always that psychological suggestion-based starting point that interested me the most. And now, I suppose, you remember Chan Canasta? Does that name ring anything?
That name does ring. Yeah. He used to be on television quite
that's
a lot.
Right.
I was young, certainly.
So sort of 50s and 60s, I guess, Polish guy, very charismatic, very commanding, very charming. I really, really liked him. And again, proper mind reader. There haven't been many of us around. So he, I suppose, David Berglas, also more recently, although he's retired now.
Still with us, though, very
still
much.
Still with us, yeah, 90... Yeah. Oh, goodness, yeah. mid-90s, 95, perhaps. So there's, people since, once I started sort of watching it, but they've always veered towards that mind-reading end of things because it just struck me that it was the more interesting form of magic, that if somebody could read your mind, that's always going to be more interesting than, finding your card. So I've always, gravitated towards that.
It's a profession that requires huge discipline, you're always sort of working on it all the time, really, aren't you?
I think it's no coincidence. It's a lot of underconfident kids that get into it. I mean, it's the quickest, most fraudulent route to impressing people, and I think that's its key and that's its appeal, and also why a lot of magicians grow up. They're a bit odd because they've never quite learned to put that aside and actually just have normal conversations with people. Which was me all through my 20s. If I wasn't doing tricks or hypnotizing you, I was a bit lost. So. I think, that why would you need to, play such a commanding and, controlling sort of role unless that was filling some sort of gap? So, yeah, I think it's important to get through that side of it. Yeah.
Is there a big spectacular planned for you in the near future, in the coming months?
No, I'm doing this show Unbelievable that's just opened. This has taken up a big chunk of time. And before that, I had a tour called Showman, which was on the road for like a year and a half and here in the West End. So that's been a very dense time. So actually, I'm taking a proper break after this. I paint and I'll be book writing and just having a nice time at home.
But in the meantime, we can all rush along, see in Unbelievable and some terrific acts on that.
Yeah. It's a bit, yeah, it's a proper family magic show. So, but we used sort of musicians and we wanted to avoid just having a bunch of magicians doing their acts and avoid any of that kind of, it's like, I don't know, sort of ego thing that gets in the way. So it's a very ego-less, very fresh way of approaching what a magic show could be. In the same way we've spent the last 20 years, I say we, it's the same little team of us that make my shows, we've sort of looked at how to reinvent what mind reading could be. We've now gone back and done this with magic. So magic shows haven't been done like this before. And it's a really joyous thing, but it's very much a family show. It's not a scary, dark, Derren Brown-y thing at all. It's a real treat.
Lovely. Criterion Theatre in London for that. And so back to 1986, Derren, and the Communards. Don't Leave Me This Way is the one we think we might play.
Lovely. That's the crowd pleaser, isn't it?
It is.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think as I did start to find my way into my brief stint of pop music, I think, the Communards must have been part of that. And I was delighted to see it was this year. And then years later, I've become friendly with the Reverend Richard Coles, who's there on these albums.
Yep,
like he was a big part of my a big part of this sort of my teenage years. And now he is just the world's best man. He's just wonderful. So I really remember a lot of singing to this song in my bedroom at home and bouncing around on the sofas, and which at 15 actually is probably, should have outgrown that. But what a great fun song, and I'm pleased we're not finishing on the chicken song. So thank you for doing it this way round.
We're all, I think, pleased about that. Derren, thank you so much for choosing these tracks and for remembering 1986.
Oh,
delight to see you.
Thanks a real treat. Thank you very much for having me, Ken. Thank you.